I was in the Masonic Museum on Goulburn Street in Sydney the other day, and I noticed this illustration titled The Grand Lodge of New Zealand. On the checkered floor, I noticed the configuration with the monument, and it reminded me of some footage I've taken with Oration in Hyde Park, and the similarities, the obvious similarities. So let's just quickly have a look at that footage.
Here in Sydney, in Hyde Park, we have this memorial. It's a World War I and World War II memorial. Around the base, we have these circular shapes. There are four of them, representing the four elements, the four directions, and the four seasons. This is where the spirit orbs would lie around here. And then we have the stonework here, representing there would be seven layers of this going in, I would suggest, esoterically. Representing the edifice of a magic ritual space, we have the pillars, which are pillars of light, and we have the tower structure, the watchtower structure in the center, I would suggest. This also dovetails as the guardian spirit in the center.
I hope you could see what I feel are obvious similarities between the Masonic illustration and the war memorial that lies in Hyde Park. Now, as far as the magic aspect of things goes, and the mage within the circle, Manly P. Hall has illustrations showing the mage with those circles around the mage, and also Cirque du Soleil provide an example of this also within their drill iron show. And you can have seven rings, but the amount can vary, but they relate perhaps to the chakras, the fields, the auric fields, if you will, around the mage. And of course, whilst the mage is in the center, they're having greater insight due to the nerve centers, the etheric nerve centers being excited. Beyond that, in this video, if you want to know more, please see my film From Other Dimensions. So, in this video, we're looking at the interdimensional aspect of war memorials, and we'll proceed on. From my point of view, and I know others out there have similar points of view, I would suggest that various wars and acts of terrorism and sacrifices, etc., are linked with the occult, with the concerns of people within occult societies, secretive societies that have access to various rituals. They perform them, they bring in entities and energies into the ritual situation, and they possibly do the bidding of these entities, and there are possibly cases of possession as well. I'm not sure about some of these things, but they are possibilities that I consider. You can look at the insignias on various groups, warring groups, armies, etc. The Australian Army has the sun. You can look at the names of various operations, the times that wars are started, the times that the troops are sent into war. And if you're used to occult matters, then you may be able to put two and two together with some of these things. But I'm not going to get into the wider field of this. But I will say that Mark Passio points out the what he terms the season of sacrifice, which starts on the equinox around March the 19th. 19th to the 22nd, and goes out to May Day, May the 1st, and you'll often see action happen within that time. This year we saw the Boston bombings happen during that time, but there are many other things that happen there. And to finish it off, you will have often marches and blood spilt on May Day marches, or you will have the death of Hitler, for example, or the death of Osama bin Laden on May Day to sort of finish things off. Well, that's what the public are told anyway. But besides all that, I want to cover the interdimensional aspect of war memorials, which is the main focus of this video. When I started out my work in 2010, there was a cafe called the Illuminati Cafe, and it was close to closing down that time, but it was at the start of Glebe Point Road. And at the start of Glebe Point Road in Sydney, there was also a monument there, which these days I think refers to a watchtower spirit with the magic circles around the bottom there. Now, in mid-2011, I met up with another researcher who lived near, very close to Glee Point Road, and he pointed out the war memorial on Glee Point Road. So, I'd heard Michael Tesarian, I'm sure it's Michael Tesarian, have actually met briefly, but I'm sure I've heard him talking about the battlefield and how it kind of esoterically relates to an altar, a sort of altar of sacrifice, if you will, with the various sort of symbols on the warring parties, the sort of esoteric symbols being on the warring parties. And I find this quite interesting. We also have the notion of spirits smelling the blood. So that's quite interesting as well. And I'll do a bit of reading to that. Back in mid-2011, when I definitely knew less then than I do now, we did a bit of an enactment there at Glebe, and I did this with my fellow researcher there. We put these soldiers on the altar there in Glebe, and it's a very B-grade performance, but what do you do? So we did that. And we have the sort of sacrifice on the altar there. In Canberra, there is an altar on Anzac Parade, and I suspect that this also sort of shows the sacrifice on the altar, but I may be incorrect. Anyway, so there you have it. We also sacrificed a bear whilst we were there. Now, this is in relation to the pedophilia aspect to things, because there definitely is a pedophile aspect that is part of this, and there's sort of these sacrificial and sexual things that are run through occultism and through the ritual process that I suspect bring in entities. And yeah, so we sacrificed this bear anyway. We made sure that we cleaned up the area at Glebe before we left, and we actually cleaned up extra rubbish that was hanging around there as well, so we left the place tidier than when we came. Personally, I have attended Anzac Day dawn services both as a Boy Scout and also as a member of a Highland pipe band playing the bagpipes. Here is an example of me playing my practice chanter. Let's move on. In the interests of adding some more depth to this video presentation, I'll now read from page 55 of Furs Morrish's book, The Ritual of Higher Magic. So reading, invisible force currents set in motion by ritual. When a group of humans possessing the normal quota of nerve centers and emotional mechanism are gathered to perform ritual, certain visible and invisible effects take place, according to the exact laws which we considered in the first part of this book. The visible effects are those mentioned above, namely the emotional stimulus and the subsequent behaviour of members of the group. The effects of jazz in a palais de danse offer examples of this. The invisible effects are those which it needs trained extrasensory perception to observe accurately and trained reason to coordinate when observed. Without this faculty of observation, the only way of judging invisible effects is by the visible ones. This is unreliable because conflicting influences may be at work modifying the visible effects. Given trained faculties for accurate observation, the following general results will be seen to take place in the supraphysical worlds surrounding the place of ritual. The atmosphere of the place will be brought into tune with the prevailing theme or keynote of the ritual. Colors, forms, and astral currents corresponding with the nature of the ritual will be formed or set in motion. The astral bodies of those taking part will be affected and swing with the psychic currents of the place and become attuned and intensified. Nature spirits and other denizens of the unseen worlds will be attracted and will add their force to the prevailing atmosphere. The whole vortex of force thus created will take a definite shape according to the mathematical values of the sound frequencies and currents set in motion. Some predominant entity of light or darkness, as the case may be, will assume control and ensoul the psychic edifice thus built, using its contents of force for one of two purposes according to whether it is a creature of light or darkness. Either to liberate and uplift those beings present, human and non-human, living and dead, or to enslave and feed on them. Ancient rituals which required human and animal sacrifices, presumably including those of the early Hebrews before their capture by civilized Babylon, were rituals of propitiation of elemental spirits, probably created by the passions of pre-Aryan peoples in Atlantis, home of black magic, entities of darkness, glorying in the separative sensations of lust and cruelty. These entities fed on the etheric fumes of blood and even materialized on the etheric level as some spirits do in the modern spiritualistic seance, by using the animal vitality of those present. This is a thing which none of the true angels of light could or would do, as materialization at such low level as the physico-etheric would be impossible for them. In the painting The Last Supper by Leonardo da Vinci, you can see Jesus representing the sun amidst the 12 houses of the zodiac. But beyond that, Jesus wears the blue and the red. The blue would represent the female energy, while the red would represent the male energy. Now, the male and female energies are very, very important within the magic ritual situation and the combination of them thereof. If we go to Canberra and we position ourselves in the area of equilibrium, as I term it, which is Anzac Parade, we can look one way and see a representation within a war memorial of male, and then we can look to the other and see female. For the female energy versus the male energy. So let's have a look at that now. So I'm now standing right in the middle of Anzac Parade here, and just across to the side here is the Korean War Memorial here on Anzac Parade. Now if we have a look at this war memorial, in the front here we see an obelisk. Now that obelisk is perhaps a penis, a phallus. To each side we have the two testicles, and on those testicles we have these streamers, if you like, which perhaps represent sperm. Now at the sides we have the pubic hairs, so to each side we have the pubic hairs, and amidst those pubic hairs rocks, which perhaps gives new meaning to getting your rocks off. Now at this side we have a man here, and he would be from the army, so all three of the forces are represented here. We have another man here in here, he would be the airman.
And then the last man here with this very phallic object, he's holding this bomb here. He would be from the Navy. So he would be a seaman, and he is amidst the pubic hairs there. Now, in behind, in between the testicles, if you will, over here, we have a ceiling up here, and in that ceiling is an opening, which is perhaps a vaginal opening, if you will, for the phallus here. But that is an obelisk, and usually around obelisks, phallic obelisks, we have the female counterpart, and we really do have that across the other side of the road here, where we have the Australian Service Nurses Memorial over here. So we'll just go and have a closer look at that, and I think you'll see what I'm talking about. So here I am outside the memorial here, and in the middle here we have these glass structures which perhaps represent the element of water, and they're curved also, and they perhaps represent the waters of the female. And to the sides here we have two steps, perhaps representing the labia minora and the labia majora. And again to this side we have this two-step configuration with the labia minora and the labia majora here. We have the grasses here around the outside. They are around other memorials here, but they do perhaps represent pubic hair. And we'll just go and have a look across the other side here. Yeah, so across the other side here we have this Vesica Pisces shape once again, this vaginal shape once again, where we have the labia minora on the inside and the labia majora on the outside. And again over here, the two-step configuration, labia minora, labia majora. In the middle here we have the bush, and you will see this on the Presbyterian Church logo also, and the bush perhaps refers to the fornix, and the bush gets burnt, and that's the burning, and that refers to enlightenment, as per the work of Bill Donohue. Here is a picture of the Australian Service Nurses National Memorial here on Anzac Parade, and this is in the as part of an article in the Freemasons magazine for the New South Wales and the ACT.
I would just like to remind and impress on people that I'm only pointing out aspects of the symbolism, and that there will be other aspects to the symbolism. Some of them I will know about and some of them I won't know about. Freemasons tell us that sacred symbolism comes from other dimensions, and I would urge people to keep this in mind. Regarding the male and female energies that we see on either side of Anzac Parade, the equilibrium I would suggest that the swastika, with the arms of the swastika, as the Freemasons tell us in this description with about the crux amanti, or the swastika, or the tetraskelion, that the swastika, those arms, represent the male and female energies. The forearms of the swastika, I would suggest, also represent the main elements, the main elemental spirits of earth, air, fire, and water. Fire and air representing male, whilst earth and water would represent female. The swastika would also represent vibration as well, and you can see the arms extending out. You can see this at the top of the what I would call a ritual chamber in the Wewelsburg Castle in Germany, used by the Nazis. And I would suggest this was used for magic rituals. In fact, I'm very, very, very sure about it. You can also see the swastika elsewhere at Martin Place in Sydney on the Commonwealth Bank building. You can see it there, sort of extended out, if you will. So this would, in a perhaps a vibrationary sort of manner. You can see some buildings in Canberra also that represent the swastika. I will do some reading now from Furze Morrish's book, and it will be from page 59. Military ritual in Europe. Observations of military ritual, especially in conjunction with brass music, show that exceedingly strong currents on the lower astral levels are set in motion, affecting the astral bodies of those within a certain range. The music might be inaudible to some, but its astral effect might take place all the same. Strong eddies of red and orange swirl around the band, creating characteristic forms in astral and mental matter, and reproducing similar eddies in the astral bodies of those within range. Being strongly red music, this would affect the lower half of the aura more than the upper part and tend to stimulate the coarser vibrations in the aura, making them expand and rise into the upper part. Unless this part is too deeply ingrained by habits of clear thinking and spirituality to be altered. The effect on the soldiery is very marked. The rhythmic marching in close formation tends to unify the consciousness of individuals, changing them temporarily into troops, as it is meant to do, checking their individual mental activities and creating a group psychology. This is the kind of mob psychology with a central discipline. The more exactly they move as one man, the more unified they tend to become. The wiseacre who claims that the modern soldier, being a technician, still does not need drill, shows he knows very little about the hidden side of things or about psychology. An interesting fact connected with Nazi ceremonial was seen in the huge swastika emblems arranged in dramatic architectural designs at mass parades. This kept the symbol before the eyes of the people and centralizing their mass mentality around the symbol. The swastika, or revolving cross, is the occult symbol of the seventh ray, a ray of occult science, ritual, and rhythmic vibration, proving that occult forces of the New Age were being employed. It is quite definitely a sign to occultists that psychic influences were at work openly. The occult effect of mass parades in Germany and Italy was to create a psychic channel through which the national angels of Germany and Italy might pour influence onto the peoples under their charge. Whether Hitler or Mussolini were aware of the existence of national angels or not does not make any difference. They affect the peoples of those countries just the same. The fact that these gangster dictators used these forces for their own ends does not invalidate the facts. The national angels of a community are the lofty beings of great power and beneficence. They are highly spiritual intelligences capable of great expansion of consciousness in complete unity themselves and therefore working ultimately with the unity of mankind, even though their charges fight with one another. They live and move through the astral mental level, where all is unity and there is no separateness, and probably do not descend into coarser vibrational forms than those of the higher mental plane, owing to the constitution of their bodies, which would not permit this. They have therefore to affect their peoples by the lesser angels and nature spirits, and by indirect means such as an outstanding personality, like a dictator. The mass parades provide psychic channels just as the Eucharistic angels of the church work through the psychic forms built by the ceremonial. In fact, Dr. Jung, probably the foremost practicing psychologist of today, gave the opinion that Hitler was not functioning as a normal man, but as the soul of Germany, the mouthpiece of 70 millions of people. This is significant coming from an accredited psychologist of Dr. Jung's reputation, such as the use of military ceremonial on a large scale. It builds a huge form through which the national angels can contact their people. Whether palpable or not to your comprehension of this reality, Furs Morris writes about national angels, entities working through the minds of peoples, and I'm certainly open to this notion when I look around and look at the reality that I perceive. Now, Belladonna is a statue within the sculpture garden of the Australian War Memorial in Canberra. And depicted on the shield that she's carrying is the earth, and looking over the earth would be an entity. And I suspect that this entity has a likeness to that of national angels, and I would suggest that it's sort of right there in front of our face, so to speak. Indeed, the spirit world is sort of depicted in so many places, I think. If you sort of open your eyes to sort of see what's around your communities and depicted in your media, etc. But anyway, let's go now for some further commentary on this sculpture by Santos Bonacci.
So this is Belladonna, the goddess of war. Bella coming from the word warlike, bellicose. A bellicose person is a person who is warlike, who likes to, start arguments and start fights, etc. Yeah, this imagery of the skull and the death, and this pertains to basically the Saturnian death cult, really. I can't see it meaning anything else. It's all about Saturn. Whenever you see the skull, he's the Grim Reaper. He's the he's got the scythe. He's old man Kronos. He's the one that watches people age and die because he controls time. Saturn has to do with time telling. It always has. Yeah, the god of war. I suppose you could point to Diana, the moon, or Mars as the god of war, the martial one. But Saturn is also, he's a killer. In one sense, you see.
Right next to the war memorial here in Hyde Park, we have the Olympic logos here with the plaque, a remnant from the Sydney Olympics 2000. And we have the elements here. We have water, air, earth and fire with the spirit in the middle. So we'll go up to the war memorial here and have a look further. If we walk into the entrance of the Anzac War Memorial here and we look upwards, we can see the pentagram, which perhaps represents the elements earth, water, air and fire plus the spirit. And we'll just keep walking in here and we can see the statue by Rainer Hoff entitled Sacrifice. Here within the Anzac Memorial there is a lot of symbolism. Above we have 120,000 stars in the dome up here. Now, if you break that down, that is 12. So what do we have 12 of above? Below here, we have a statue by created by Freemason Rainer Hoff. And we have the man here on the Sword of Mars. And we have what is perhaps the sun or the black sun below here. We also have the black sun represented three times around the sides. It's over in here and it's over here, and we have the regular sun here. Above each of these in these alcoves we have the keystone above there. Over here we have the eternal flame, as we do in all of the war memorials. Now above we have what is perhaps a representation of the elements. So up here we have the airman representing air, whilst over here we have the female representing earth. Over this side we have a man, a soldier with a gun in the line of fire perhaps, representing the element of fire. And if we come around this way and look up, we can see a man from the Navy representing water. The four elements are perhaps represented, I would certainly say. This man here holds a bomb. He doesn't have a shirt on. This is a very masculine, phallic looking representation up here. An accentuation, if you will, of the male aspect.
From here on in, I'd just like to wrap things up and I'll try and be concise, but I have a few things to say. So, within the war memorial at Hyde Park, you have that central pillar. I identified that pillar some time back as the Black Sun, and it wasn't until I returned to the War Memorial and saw the outer Black Suns above that I realized that I was probably on the money. Now, represented on the Kabbalah, you can have the sort of whiter pillar, which would be the pillar of the sun, and the darker pillar, which would be the feminine pillar of the moon. But there is perhaps a black pillar also. So you have the soldier on that pillar with the shield and the sword of Mars. Mars, the martial one, the god of war. Freemason Reinerhof designed this statue and it's titled Sacrifice, and he was a veteran of World War I. So he was a Freemason, and Freemasons, for example, go to war and die at war, and you know, they are the brothers. I know Freemasons sort of get blamed for, it's almost popular to blame Freemasons for this, that, and the other thing, but you know, Freemasons have been responsible for the setup of America and so forth, for so many things throughout society, and I'm not really pro-Freemasonry, or I'm not really anti-Freemasonry. But I believe that there are nefarious things that happen within Freemasonry, and there are good things that happen within Freemasonry also. That said, let's move on. So you have that central pillar. Now, the black sun would represent an aspect of the sun and or Saturn. And so that would be an entity or an energy. Now, entities get brought into the ritual situation, and they are perhaps sort of depicted within that pillar, and also without, and sort of out of, in and out of the spirit orbs also, I would suggest. That's what I suspect. Now, so they are there, and they do get visualized within these ritual situations, and I think that they are depictions are put within public places here, there, and everywhere. Now, the Shrine of Remembrance down in Melbourne and the Australian War Memorial would go along very similar lines to, in fact, pretty much the same as the memorial in Hyde Park in Sydney, where you'd have that central beam, and then you have representations of the elements around the outsides. In the case of Melbourne, it would be just the four walls would be representing each of the elements. But the elements are well represented in Canberra, especially with the pillars. But you also have the four people around the outside as well. I don't want to spend too much time on this. You have the altars in the center of the space. Furs Morris depicts the altar in the center. There's a lot I could say about the altar as well. We have spirits gathering around the altar and on top of the altar. The altar, and I've heard this from word of mouth, that the altar is imbued with the equal energies. A proper altar is imbued with the equal energies, the equal masculine and feminine energies in the center there. As that's sort of part of what the altar is. Another thing we should look at also that I should have put in was that I found a map, and that map depicts the spirit on Anzac Parade. That's the area that I call the area of equilibrium, and that fits in sort of perfectly, I would suggest, with what I'm suggesting there about the area of equilibrium, which would represent the pillar of light, for example, within the magic ritual space. Because you have the elements around the outside in a certain configuration with the spirit in the center. Although, of course, I expect that magic rituals, there are many variations, and you know, things don't have to be fixed. For further curiosity, author Guy Freeland informs us that the red gravel on Anzac Parade represents the blood of the battlefield, spilt blood. And in a way, Anzac Parade sort of flows down, if you will, from the altar. There is a large altar there. Now, that altar sits in front of the Australian War Memorial. The Australian War Memorial would represent the cross in part, the cross that we are informed that Jesus was sacrificed on. And you can also see the pelican represented in the 18th degree of Freemasonry, sacrificing blood also to its young. Furthermore, the floor plan of the Australian War Memorial would also, I would suggest, represent the floor plan of Solomon's Temple, perhaps too. In Parramatta Park in Sydney, you have the broken pillar in the centre. I don't want to get into the what that could mean, but you can see that it's possibly represented on the Kabbalah. The broken pillar is also represented in a similar fashion in Liverpool and Sydney also, so I think that's very interesting. The Bomber Command War Memorial in Canberra has the centre beam depicted in the centre of the magic circle. With the outer, you have the outer participants of the magic circle around the outside. In this case, there are seven depicted, and they don't have to necessarily be in a full circle, I would suggest. Although I would suggest that certain magic rituals require certain amounts of participants. I'd just like to digress now and talk about the British Medical Association building situated on Macquarie Street in Sydney. You can see the what I would suggest are the guardian spirits and spirits on the outside of the building, on the facade. And if you go into the foyer, you can see the light there. And I would suggest that that light represents that beam of light in the center of the ritual situation. And unsurprisingly, we would have the serpent represented on the floor directly below with the checkers around it also. Now that serpent would be an etheric serpent that comes up that center, up the pole, if you will, that light pole. So the serpent would be an etheric energy, if you will, an etheric tube. In Dendera, in Egypt, you have what some people consider depictions of light bulbs. I would suggest that this is not the case at all. I'll just go through a few quick points. There are the participants there with their heads, the people with their heads joined to the so-called light bulb. Now, why would you have sort of heads joined in certain ways to a light bulb? No, it's not the case. You have the lotus also. Now, the lotus would represent the chakras and the like. So it would represent an etheric area, and the snake would represent etheric energy emanating from it. And that's what you have there, with a field depicted around it. Indeed, within Egypt, you can find the snake without that field depicted around it, whilst you still have the lotus there. So why would you not have that so-called bulb there? It wouldn't make for a light bulb, would it? No, it's not a light bulb. And also the snake tail, really, I mean, those snake tails don't make it down to, I mean, it just doesn't work. They don't make it totally into the lotus. The tail sort of sits up. It wouldn't sort of mechanically join in there. It doesn't make sense. In Sydney at Darling Park, you have the swastika design within the lotus, and that would be the vortex, you know, that same swirling, the way it's like that snake sort of snaking up and swirling, those swirling energies of male and female. So it's all the same thing. Now the swastika is sort of at one in a way with the sun, because these energies that the swastika represents are used within the magic ritual to sort of make contact with the sun, with the spirits of the sun and the energies of the sun. And indeed, according to Furs Morris, the sun has its own elementals, as does the moon also. And it's these elementals that are used within the magic ritual edifice to sort of bring it all together, if you will, to open up the windows, if you will, to see into these other dimensions, and to bring spirits into the ritual situation, which is what all this, you know, these different entities are from the other planets and so forth. You get Taurus represented in Liverpool, for example. The energies of Taurus brought into, I would suggest, brought into the ritual situation. But entities are brought in that are visualized within those rituals as well. That is what happens. It is my strong opinion that many people high up within society, and I believe that this has been going on for many thousands of years, that people high up within society, such as the royals, such as people high up within the religious sects, the high priests, and people high up within the secretive societies, engage in the bringing in of energies and entities into the magic ritual edifice, and that there is a communication there, and that there are possible benefits also to the mage, to the people within the edifice, such as the raising of the senses and the likes, perhaps. This is a big, big unknown to the general public. It is as if the general public themselves are under some sort of spell and just can't see it. For whatever reason, some of us seem to be able to sort of we have the propensity to sort of break away and just see a little more. But for the most part, the general public are going to be out of the picture on this one. What does this mean? As far as possible possessions go, as far as people doing the bidding of various entities, it's a big unknown. I just find it very curious that the war memorials show interdimensional aspects along with the other bits and pieces that are symbolized on the militaries around the world. I see no difference between the swastika and the rising sun of the Australian Army, for example. It's all occult symbolism along the same lines, along the same rituals, and I'll leave it at that. I hope you enjoyed the video. So best of luck, and bye for now.